Hello everyone. Today I'd like to talk about routing. If you're not familiar, routing a device is where you gain low-level access to the underlying hardware and software. Normally when a mobile phone, an Android device, is sold to you, it comes in a locked fashion. Now that means the device manufacturer has locked down certain parts of the device so that you can't go playing around or breaking your device or anything like that. Now, if you root a phone, what you do is you're basically taking over part of that security control so that you can actually gain access to the low-level functions. So for instance, there's a whole raft of your Android device you will never ever see if you aren't rooted. And this is actually where things like your applications and data are really stored, in cached files and so on. So there's quite a lot you can do once you have your device rooted. And one of the key things I want to show you is backing things up. A lot of the time when we run our Android devices, we store all our data on there. We store our applications on there, and the app file is stored on Google servers, and we can download that anytime we want. But the data itself, so you know, your high scores, what level you've got to, or any other personal information, might not, well, definitely won't be stored by Google. So the problem we have is if something happens to our device, our Samsung device, or if we want to run ROMs or experimental software on there, we run the risk of losing that personal data. So when your device is rooted, you can use an app called Titanium Backup. And the idea with Titanium Backup is it copies all of the data on your phone, including any cached data, personal data, related to each application, and stores it for you. And it'll store it on the SD card or within the device itself, on its own memory. And then you can send all of that data that Titanium Backup has saved for you, and you can put it on a cloud storage service like Dropbox, like Box.com, or Boxnet, should I say, and on Google Drive. So this is my Titanium Backup. And you can see the various settings that I currently have in use. If I go on to Backup and Restore, here are all of the apps currently stored on my device, but you can see here, I've just finished refreshing this device, so I don't have a huge amount on here of actual running apps, as it were, installed. But if I keep coming down this list, in a moment you'll start seeing things with lines through them. And these are the items that are stored on my, there we go, on my SD card, and these have been backed up by Titanium Backup. So as you can see here, lots and lots of games and other various applications. And if I want to restore one of these, all I have to do is select it. Let's just pick one that's not too big, because obviously the larger the file that you're trying to restore or back up, the longer it will take on the device. But let's just pick something quick and easy. Let's take Google Earth. And all I do is hit up and restore. I'll have the app only on this one. And it will start restoring. And that's it, done. Now I can come into my app tray, find Google Earth, and there's the application. And you can see, because that was stored actually on my SD card, the installation time, etc., it didn't have to wait to go and do any downloading or anything like that first. It just worked. Within Titanium Backup, let's go back in, you can set up schedules. So I have a few schedules here, and my most important ones are my sync to Dropbox and my sync to Google Drive. And what will happen is those will activate whenever the phone is on power and the timer is hit, 12:13, 14:26. And it will then run those, well, that's the last run times, but it will basically run any time it's on power and a timer is met. So if I go into edit here, so elements to sync, history coverage, remote location, and basically it will just run this anytime it's on power for this particular one. If it's on power, it starts uploading to Dropbox and Google Drive, and all of my stuff is stored there automatically, which means that if I need to, I can hop onto Dropbox. Say I have lost something off my SD card. I don't keep all nearly 7 gig, I think, of data backed up actually on my device, only the ones that I'm probably going to want to restore, if effectively anything over the last 6 weeks or so. But if I do need something that's older, I can go and grab it off Dropbox, pop it straight onto the phone, and then restore it quite happily. There is a wealth of options in here. You can do all sorts of clever things. So if you go in and create a new backup routine or routine, in here you have all sorts of different things that you can do as schedules. So verifying all of the backup routines, backing everything up, redoing the backups, keeping a history so that you can actually create staged backups. So effectively you can have a backup one of an app, backup two of an app, backup three of an app, and as many as you want, or it will start overwriting once it reaches a certain point. So that allows you to keep different versions. So for instance, save games is one of the easiest ones to look at there. So, you know, save the game, save one, save two, save three. And because it's saving from Titanium backup rather than within the game, you get a better kind of snapshot as you're going along, in my opinion. No chance of you overwriting your save games. So it works quite nicely from that perspective. But you have all sorts of stuff in here. It's well worth looking at as an app. If you come into the actual settings and preferences, even more options in here. Absolutely loads of stuff. This is an app that does take a little bit of getting used to. You'll have to play around with it a little bit. Every device is different, and every setup will be slightly different in what you're trying to do with it. Have a play around. If you find that an app gets jammed, so it won't actually restore or anything like that, or it seems to be taking a long time, go and check within your settings and just make sure that in developer options, you've got USB debugging turned on. That's the primary problem that you get with Titanium Backup. If you haven't got USB debugging turned on, it can start failing, causing all sorts of weird problems. That's Titanium Backup. Now we will look at something called ROM Toolbox. So with ROM Toolbox, it's a collection of tools for those people who are rooted. Easy enough. In here you've got ROM management, so if you're the sort of person that loves to install custom ROMs from the community, you've got that in there. An app manager, it's basically an uninstaller. The root browser, now this is probably one of the most useful features for anyone who runs root. This will allow you to actually get into your data folder, and this is where the actual gubbins really of all your applications are stored. So regardless of Titanium Backup, which kind of is a quite simple interface really to actually allow you to get into all of this data and back it up, you can just copy these yourself if you wanted to. Titanium Backup does a few other things as well. It helps to freeze an application so that you can actually back it up without causing other problems. But you know, with root toolbox, you've got a way to get directly into your root files, make any modifications you need to there. There's a scripter and terminal emulator for those people who are into more throwing Linux commands basically at your device. An ad blocker, auto start manager, config for apps to SD. That really doesn't work on Samsung devices. And a quick rebooter as well. But also in here are abilities to control your CPU and kernel tweaks. And another really useful feature is the build prop. You have to be really careful in build prop if you're rooted. You can basically destroy your phone, or at very least destroy your ROM that you're currently running. You have to reload your ROM. One thing that a lot of people like to tweak, certainly on the Galaxy Note 2, is the LCD density. Mine is set at 290, the default is 320. The lower you go, up to a certain point, the smaller on-screen text and icons become. You can fit more on your screen. A lot of people on the Note 2 like to tweak it down a bit just to make the icons feel a little bit more sharp and contained. One note of caution there, do not drop that too low. I think if you drop it under about 270, the Android keyboard, the Samsung stock keyboard, stops working, and you'll probably have to reinstall all of your software again on your phone and re-ROM to get everything working again. 290 is quite a nice happy medium, I find. SD booster, you can go into here and you can actually set the cache value, I believe. The higher the cache value, the faster data will be stored and read back from the device. You can then run a benchmark if you want, and it will calculate which setting you should probably be using. I tend to find 1 meg is more than ample and does quite a good job. But that's ROM Toolbox. You also have some interface controls in there, font installer, boot animations. Once you have root level access, you can change the things in your device that you don't really like. A lot of people really like changing their boot animations from the stock Samsung one. Again, things like the status bar icons and theme chooser. So you can change up all of these icons up here and so on that would appear across the top of your screen. I've seen some really nice custom Wi-Fi logos, for instance. All of that is available once you root. Words of warning. If you root your device, I'm afraid, generally speaking, you invalidate your warranty. There is some discussion, debate, under European law as to whether a device manufacturer actually can invalidate a warranty when you've rooted or updated the software to a custom ROM. Bearing in mind that warranties tend to be for hardware, not for software. So if you root your device, that's a software thing. It's not a hardware thing. So physically, if you root your device and you can install another ROM on it and your problem, whatever you were having, goes away, well, it was a software issue. If the device won't boot, if there's a physical hardware fault, well, that would still be covered under warranty because software can't really break hardware. At least not unless you were like messing around with your CPU governor and you overclocked your device. But even then, it's really up to Samsung to prove that that you fiddling with it actually caused the problem. If it's a hardware fault, well, they have to look at the hardware first. They can't really look at the software under European law and say, well, the software broke it. That just isn't realistic and doesn't really gel well with the European laws we have currently. If you're outside of Europe, I'm afraid pretty much warranty void when you root. And Samsung are very clever. They have quite a few tricks inside the system which can set a counter called triangle. And that will basically keep a total of the number of times you've ROMed your phone, etc. You can get applications which remove those alerts for Samsung called Triangle Away. So there's plenty of ways that you can revert, put the phone it back into a pristine, unrooted state if you want to. A lot of the details for how to do this is on YouTube or on xdadevelopers.com. What I would always suggest, make xdadevelopers.com your first port of call when you want to root an Android device or a Samsung device. Find the forum for your device. Make sure that if you're dealing with a device that has multiple versions around the world, like for instance, it's never a good idea to use ROMs for a US Samsung device if it was actually designed for an international device. It simply won't work and it will cause damage to the phone, potentially. So do check in the XDA forums. In there you'll also find a ton of people willing to help you get started, as well as guides exactly step by step how to root your phone, how to install new ROMs, etc. Or take a quick look around YouTube. There are so many videos out there how to do this. Personally, I stay away from making routing videos because everybody's already doing it.